Hello and welcome once again to Into the Music on ABC RN. I'm Gretchen Miller and, well, music lovers, as I'm sure you've noticed, are a curious lot. When we find something we really like, we can't wait to tell everyone about it and often complain about the fact that the artists we love are not so well known as we want them to be. But the only thing worse than this loved artist being ignored by the masses is that same artist being suddenly noticed and loved by the masses. Somehow our privacy has been invaded. The special relationship we used to enjoy with the artist has been stretched among far too many people. Surprisingly, the artists themselves often feel the same way. Imagine this process going on an industrial scale, 100 or more beloved underground sensations at a time, suddenly finding they're selling their CDs to the kind of people who only buy 2 albums a year, and you've got some idea of what it's like to be into or to be making alternative rock music in the mid to late 90s. In the 5th show of his series, Love in the 90s, author Craig Shufton shows us how alternative rock artists like Beck, Green Day, Garbage and Courtney Love reacted to this wider audience, how their shock at coming face to face with the masses pushed their art into curious shapes and led them to create some of the most ambitious and enduring music of the decade.
What happened when alternative music first came out was authentic. It was a reflection of what was happening at the time, and it had to do with authenticity. So
this is the reflection of the authenticity now. We're in the reflection of it.
Music means time.
The 1990s were.
It's an alternative.
Love. 90s.
An alternative history of alternative rock.
What, louder, baby.
This is a story about unpopular music and what happens to it when it becomes popular. It's about a handful of underground or alternative bands from Britain and America in the early 90s who suddenly found themselves in places where those kind of bands were not normally supposed to be. On commercial radio, on national TV, standing on stage in concert halls and stadiums in front of thousands of people. They called it alternative rock because it began as a choice outside of the mainstream if you didn't like what was in the mainstream in the 1980s.
People are tired of listening to the stuff they usually have to listen to on the radio, and they want to hear new, different stuff, a variety as it were.
I think things are getting a bit stale.
To be in an alternative band or to be into alternative music back then felt like being part of an opposition. You played it or you supported it because you knew that it was better than the standard option. And for many, the goal was not just to offer something different to the mainstream, but to replace it entirely. To see your band or your friend's band or the band that you loved on TV instead of Poison, Motley Crue. Guns N'
Roses. Hair bands.
I moved to Los Angeles in the middle of Guns N' Roses and I found Eric. And all I wanted to do was fuck them up because they made me mad.
And me and Eric were like,
let's start a band, we'll call it Hole, we're going to crush these hair bands.
In 1991, Courtney Love got her wish. After the success of Nirvana, Pearl Jam, Hole, Faith No More, L7 and the Red Hot Chili Peppers, the old hard rock was more or less wiped off the map, which meant that alternative rock effectively became mainstream rock.
Yeah, it is like that.
Smash. Smashing.
It's like this alternative rock thing, you know. Like, I don't know how many times I've heard that word get thrown around, alternative, alternative. It's like, alternative to what? You know, I mean, the media has really sucked up all of it. You know, it is the, you know, main genre of music that people are, it's like, that's really popular right now. And you know, when you think, I think of alternative music, I think of like just something different from what's happening in the mainstream, you know, and this is about as mainstream as you can get.
By the mid-1990s, alternative rock had become boring. Grunge was boring, flannel shirts were boring, and complaining about being famous was getting really, really boring. Even guitars were becoming boring. It was time for a change. It had become necessary, in other words, for someone or something to offer an alternative to alternative.
Hi!
From the Australian perspective anyway, it's good to have a fresh smell. It's good to see a band that don't wear flannelette shirts.
We don't smell fresh, exactly.
I meant it metaphorically, okay?
Oh, good, that's good.
This was Green Day, a 3-piece punk band from Berkeley, California. They had short, spiky hair and wrote short, spiky songs played fast and loud. They sang about things kids could easily relate to, like boredom, parents, school, and TV.
I'll sit around and watch the tube, but nothing's on. I change the channels for an hour or two. Tweet all my thumbs just for a bit. I'm sick of all the same old shit. In the house with unlocked doors and I'm fucking late.
That got you guys into music? What bands were you listening to? Was it the first, like the Buzzcocks, Clash, Sex Pistols wave of punk, or was it the X, Demo X?
No, it was just more of the community that we're surrounded with.
They'd evolved out of a thriving local punk scene in Berkeley, California, centered around a cooperative punk sharehouse on the city's Gilman Street. Here, the band developed their aesthetic and their ideals, including the idea that punk could be melodic and poppy, as long as it remained uncomplicated.
Three instruments, two voices, sometimes three.
That's it.
And that the music was fundamentally about resisting the messages of the mass media.
Turn it off.
And thinking for yourself.
Punk rock to me is doing whatever you want to do.
Something different from what's happening in the mainstream.
Like a real subculture of people that are just like dedicated to, you know, creating something of their own that is goes against the mainstream.
The mainstream definitely isn't going against Green Day. Over 3 million copies of Dookie have already sold.
So now that the album is out, it's doing really well, you're getting MTV play now.
Hi.
You're watching
120 minutes.
So keep watching and
no, don't keep watching.
Camera.
Turn it off. Wait, turn it off after the next video, which is ours, and then everything else sucks.
Of course, there were diehard punk purists who saw Green Day on MTV and immediately wrote the group off as sellouts. These people wrote a lot of letters to music magazines and punk newsletters about how Green Day and other bands like The Offspring were killing the scene by exposing it to the mainstream. By and large, the complaints were not so much about the quality of the band's music as about the quality of its audience, the new and mostly unwelcome faces you saw at these groups' shows as a result of their music appearing in the mainstream media. Green Day, of course, had noticed this too.
So now that the album is out, it's doing really well, you're getting MTV play now, you're getting a lot of radio play. Have you noticed a change in your gigs, the crowds that have been coming to your gigs now?
Yeah, there's a lot more meatheads that show up lately.
The appearance of these guys, these aggressive, shirtless, macho college guys at Green Day shows, came as a big surprise to the band. Back in 1990, they wouldn't have been seen within a mile of a punk show of any description. These were the kind of guys who only found out about a band once it was in the top 40 or on MTV. And prior to 1991, punk rock never appeared on MTV. In those days, the music was still something of a secret. You had to know about it to know where it was happening. Now that the band were on MTV, the secret was out. Everybody knew about Green Day, and anybody could come to their shows.
I don't know, you know, you're playing to the masses instead of relating by seeing everyone's head in the back of the club or something.
The masses. You'll remember that back in the early 90s, alternative rock bands had gone to quite a bit of trouble to attract their attention. Chris Novoselic hoped that these mainstream teens would undergo a revolution in taste.
Some kid from the mainstream who hasn't been exposed to bands like Sonic Youth or Mudhoney, they'll understand that there's more to music.
But if Novoselic had assumed that this new audience would be someone like the old one on a bigger scale, he was in for a surprise. Beck Hansen went to a Nirvana show early in 1992 and was taken aback by what he saw there.
So many meatheads, yeah. Standing right here with the beer in my hand and my mouth is full of sand and I don't understand.
By 1993, these had become such a problem for Nirvana that singer Kurt Cobain issued an open letter to what he described as the racists, sexists and homophobes in his audience, telling them not to come to his shows and not to buy the records. Shedding the unwanted part of their audience was a priority for Nirvana, to the extent that when they began talking about their follow-up to Nevermind, drummer Dave Grohl said he hoped it would do the opposite to its predecessor, that is, repel rather than attract those kids from the mainstream.
All the radio listeners or the MTV watchers or whoever just like really test them and shove something totally aggro in their face and see if they can handle that.
I don't know, you know, you're playing to the masses.
The audience is getting bigger. The audience is obviously expanding.
I guess to a good degree, dumber sometimes too.
Here, Hole singer Courtney Love touches on a key question regarding the mainstream success of underground music. Was this new audience dumber because it was comprised of a lot of stupid people? People who believed everything they saw on TV and went to concerts purely to get drunk and start fights? Or was there something about the mass distribution and large-scale presentation of rock music in the 90s that made people stupid? Something to do with the way people behave when they're grouped together as a mass? On Green Day's 1994 tour, singer Billy Joe Armstrong decided to conduct some audience research.
Hey, everybody, how many stupid people are here tonight? Like that, and then everyone go, yeah! And we're like, no, you don't understand. I think you're dumb, you know? I don't think you're... I think you have a very low IQ. I think you're stupid.
If punk rock was, as the band liked to say, about doing whatever you want to do, then this audience was not very punk. There was something truly disturbing about the stadium crowd's tendency to move as one, to slavishly cheer and clap in all the right places, agree with everything the singer was saying, whether they thought about it or not. And if you combine this herd-like mentality with the macho qualities of some of the new audience members,
you know, dicks that, like, jump on people,
you had something truly frightening and potentially very dangerous. As Courtney Love discovered one night in 1994.
Last night, I staged out an incredibly beautiful nighty, I might add, and it was ripped off of me, and the gentlemen that worked for me kept trying to cover me up, and I was like, no, I've been naked in front of people before, it's okay. I was just screaming, you know, why did you do that? Why didn't you just pass me back the way you do Eddie, like a football hero? Why'd you have to rape me?
By the mid-90s, it had become a priority for alternative bands to diffuse this aggressive macho energy at shows, to create a more tolerant mood, and to attract a more sensitive crowd.
Our audience is actually very diverse, 50-50, male, female. A lot of the kids seem very sensitive. We don't really get like a headbanger, you know, this masculine, we want a rock crowd.
That's Butch Vig, producer of Nirvana's Nevermind and the Smashing Pumpkins' Siamese Dream, speaking about his own band, Garbage, formed in 1994 with Duke Erickson, Steve Marker, and singer Shirley Manson. They'd succeeded in scaring away the We Want a Rock crowd, it seemed, by simply not playing rock music, or not in a form that many people would have recognized it in the mid-90s.
About 2 years ago, Steve and Duke and I started collaborating on remixes for other artists like U2 and Nine Inch Nails and Depeche Mode and House of Pain. And
the remixing process, sampling and recycling sounds, looping and layering, became the basis of Garbage's method.
That was the sensibility that inspired us to start a band, because we were writing again and we were manipulating sound again.
And also inadvertently provided them with a name.
A friend of ours walked in when we were doing a Nine Inch Nails remix, and at that point the mix is really noisy, there was very little music on it, and he said, what the hell is this? It sounds like Garbage. And I got kind of defensive and said, well, we're going to turn this garbage into a song at some point.
Eventually, the trio's noisy collages started to sound like songs, and they started looking around for a singer. As it turned out, they didn't have to look far. In fact, Steve Marker found Garbage's singer on his couch.
Saw Shirley on MTV. She was in a band called Angelfish.
They played the video exactly once.
So we called her up and asked her if she wanted to come and sing a couple of songs with us.
But it sounds really weird that they picked me out of obscurity from a video on MTV. Nobody could have predicted, including ourselves, how well it would actually turn out for us. I wouldn't advise anybody else to go about it the way that we did.
It shouldn't have worked, because this is not the way that things were usually done in the world of alternative rock. Not for real bands, anyway. The proper way to do it was to get together in a basement or shed with a few friends, rehearse, start playing gigs, and build up a following of fans. Eventually, you might get to record an album, but ideally, the album should be as faithful a document of your live show as possible, using nothing more than the guitars, bass, and drums you use on stage. You might be tempted to make a video and try and get on MTV, but you probably shouldn't, because that's selling out. Garbage, on the other hand, began in the recording studio. They made an album using computers and samplers and then poached a singer from another band, whom they'd never met, to front the group, and finished their album without ever having played a gig. In fact, the very first time they stood on the stage and held their instruments was when they were shooting a music video for the first single, and it was only at this point that it occurred to them that it might be fun to, you know, get together and play some shows.
After the first run-through, we kind of looked around at each other and thought, God, we could actually do this. That's when we realized, you know, that we
kind of had an itch to play live.
But in the case of Garbage, this was much easier said than done.
Well, it was our first show, so we use that as an excuse. But the show came to an abrupt halt when the technology failed us, or we failed it, I don't know which.
This, the sight of a group of producers standing on stage behind a flown-in female singer, unable to play their music because they rely on a computer to make the damn thing work, was literally the kind of thing that alternative rock had been put on Earth to destroy. Fake bands making over-technologized rock music. Grunge's reassuring the humanist vision of long-haired every-dudes playing real instruments in real time had been necessary in 1991 as a corrective for the excesses of the 1980s.
Things were getting a bit stale.
But by the mid-90s, this formula had itself become a problem, and no one knew it better than Butch Vig, who was still turning down offers to produce Nirvana-sounding rock albums when Garbage went on tour in 1996.
Everybody calls you up at once. You to make them sound quote-unquote alternative.
In the meantime, the technology as well as the social situation of music had changed dramatically, leaving grunge and punk bands stranded in a kind of nostalgic fantasy land of working class expression. Green Day liked to think they knew fake music when they heard it.
Girls just want to have fun. Girls just want to have fun.
As an alternative to this decadent robot pop, they offered real rock.
The basic form of rock and roll, the rawest forms of rock and roll.
We're doing it.
It's what we've been doing. Three instruments, two voices, sometimes three.
That's it.
Then that's it.
But in a way, this was an 80s idea transplanted awkwardly into the 90s. In 1984, only superstar producers working with top-dollar session musos could afford to buy samplers and digital synths. In 1994, techno was far quicker and cheaper and required less musical chops to make than Dookie had.
You're the fire starter, twisted fire starter.
If punk was about ordinary people having access to the means of production, might The Prodigy or Too Unlimited be the new punk? Stephen Malkmus of Pavement wasn't ruling it out.
My guitar is still the kind of proletarian instrument that anyone can play, and it's cheap to learn, and so I think that will always keep it sort of down to earth. But with the technology being so cheap with computers now and hip-hop DJ stuff being accessible to everyone, maybe that's gonna change in the future, and that will be the true, because if you can mix an album at home on computer, that's gonna be even easier and more direct and less expensive than going to a studio to make a Pearl Jam record, you know. So
this idea of sampling as a new urban folk music had already been seized upon by Beck in 1992. Beck was basically a folk musician who also liked punk and had a keen interest in hip-hop. Usually he just recorded by himself with an acoustic guitar, but one night, goofing off with rap producer Carl Stevenson, he started playing around with a sampler.
We touched the buttons, and they were tender, yet forceful, and then the beats came forth, surged, like a wave. And on that quest, our rhythm was born.
So Beck, your song Loser Man is a smash hit. How do you feel about that?
I'm a driver, I'm a winner. Things are gonna change, I can feel it.
On his second album, Odelay, he took this approach a crucial step further when he teamed up with the Dust Brothers, producers of the Beastie Boys album Paul's Boutique, to make a record in the living room of their home in Los Angeles. Just as Malkmus had suggested 2 years earlier, the three made hours of brilliant, innovative music. With little more than a microphone, a computer, a record collection, and a crappy old bass guitar, without ever having to set foot in a professional recording studio. Where's that? Odelay signaled a major sea change for American music in the 90s. In the wake of its success, more and more alternative artists began learning from hip-hop. This was very fitting in a way, since Odelay was an album largely born of the frustration that Beck felt with the conformity and sameness of the alternative nation, a feeling he'd first experienced as a performer on the 1995 Lollapalooza tour.
With Sonic Youth, Sinead O'Connor, Cypress Hill, Hole, Beck.
Hi, Beck.
Hello.
Do you have any back-in-the-day rhymes you could maybe give us?
I ate my rake, I shake and bake. Time to quake. This was a big mistake.
I think you're right. Yeah.
An open road where I can breathe, where the lowest low is calling to me. I can pull myself back up, back down, stuck together like a ready-made.
He tried very hard over the course of the tour to connect with the faces he saw out in the crowd, but found that they wanted nothing more from him than the hit they'd seen him singing on MTV. When he played that, they all sprang to life and started moshing. When he stopped, they went back to being bored and distracted.
All moshing completely stopped.
He got so tired of this that he stopped playing the song. And then, after a while, he started playing it again, because whatever.
We did it. You know, it's no big deal. It's just a song.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you cannot do it, and people go, oh, how clever, they didn't do it. What smartasses they are, you know. And we did that a bunch, and after a while, it was like, oh, let's do it. It's just a song.
Beck was deeply disturbed by the conformity and apathy of the people he saw out there in the crowd.
That mentality doesn't really equate freedom and individuality. It sort of equates just a mindless herd.
It was ironic, considering that he'd written Loser as a kind of protest against 80s conformity.
It wasn't meant to be like a slacker thing. It was meant to be more of a, like an individuality thing or something. It's okay to be yourself, even though it's not, you know, the traditionally accepted images in popular culture.
The slacker label really pissed you off.
Labels, you know, slap them on, you know, they eventually they'll fall off. The breeze is blowing hard enough.
Beck, and this is Beck. So Beck, your song Loser Man is a smash hit. How do you feel about that?
It's like, surfing in some oil spillage.
Yeah, it is like that.
Smash. No? Smashing.
I really like your clothes.
Thanks.
Like, where do you buy them?
Salvation Army. It's like a thrift store place where you buy just junk and stuff.
I really like secondhand clothing, you know, just because, you know, usually you find one and no one else is going to have it. Being an individual, you know. I think that's kind of what fashion's all about.
Doing whatever you want to do.
Flannel and mosh.
The trend right now is to be unique and individual.
But if everybody's trying to be unique and individual.
Doing whatever you want to do.
Something different from what's happening in the mainstream.
I don't know why I think that's so important. I guess being an individual, you know. I think that's kind of what fashion's all about, is, you know, being an individual.
Alternative rock's promise was that it would help its fans break out of conformist stereotypes and realize themselves as individuals. And in this sense, its pitch was almost identical to that of the fashion industry, which is perhaps why, as early as 1992, punk icon Henry Rollins appeared in an advertisement for Gap clothing under the slogan, For Individuals. Now, in 1998, Hole singer Courtney Love appeared at the Oscars wearing a tailor-made Versace gown. People accused her of betraying the movement's principles, but what were those again?
All right. You!
At a press conference to announce the release of Hole's new album, Celebrity Skin.
Only feminists! No, guys, no testicles, only females.
A reporter asked Love to comment on Versace Gate, and the singer gave her haters a short lesson in cultural history, or evolution, or something.
Well, you know, the deal is about fashion is that proletariat male rock critics have a real Bruce Springsteen problem with, like, denim boomer issues. We as females have thousands and thousands of years of fashion in our DNA. We want to wear nice fucking clothes. It's part of what we do. So I don't have an issue with it. If you have an opportunity to go to the Oscars in a fabulous gown and be absolutely fabulous, you're gonna fucking take it. Like, listen to a rule. Who made that rule? Some dumb guy. Am I right?
Oh, yeah.
When she'd formed her band with Eric Erlandson at the end of the 80s, it was specifically with the idea that they might destroy the male establishment of rock, which at that time, in Los Angeles, meant hair metal.
Let's start a band. We'll call it Hole. We're going to crush these hair bands.
Back then, the brightest stars in the hair band firmament were Guns N' Roses. And this group in particular became a target for Love's frustration and a fuel for her ambition.
All I wanted to do was fuck them up, because they made me mad.
It wasn't just that they were in Courtney Love's way. Guns N' Roses were the ultimate expression of LA rock's sexist hegemony, an explicitly misogynist culture constructed and maintained for the benefit of men.
Well, in the hair band world, there was no room for girls.
And there no room for girls. And girls were like the prime, you know, exploitation and prize out of it.
Love wondered to herself what would happen if the women she saw at hard rock shows put even half the time they spent on trying to sleep with Skid Row's drummer into learning to play guitar.
Women are the future of rock and roll, and that's it. Get some guitars. This is the 90s. Empower yourself.
By the time Love said this in 1994, the revolution seemed already to be underway. Hair metal had gone the way of the dinosaur, and MTV had been taken over by righteous female rock stars like Kim Gordon, Kim Deal, Liz Phair, PJ Harvey, L7, and Elastica.
Definitely, right now there's a lot of young women coming along doing what I do, so we're sort of in a group together.
Rock had finally made room for girls, but what to call this new thing?
L7 are one of several all-girl post-punk acts to have emerged from America's West Coast. The bands are collectively known as Riot Girls.
L7 and Hole were often referred to in the music press as Riot Girl bands, but this was a misnomer. Riot Girl referred to a specific collective of bands, zine writers and activists centered around Evergreen College in Olympia, Washington.
We're Bikini Kill, and we want revolution! Girls don't
know! It's not hard to see why people might have mistaken Courtney Love for a Riot Girl. They used the same language and imagery when talking about the place of women in rock, and even looked a bit alike, since they shared a preference for dyed black slips and 90s, hair worn in barrettes, and smeared lipstick. The big difference is that in the early 90s, and especially after the release of Hole's 1994 album, Live Through This, Courtney Love seemed to be on MTV every day, on the cover of every other magazine. Riot Girl bands, on the other hand, were nowhere to be seen in the mass media. The movement was fiercely anti-corporate, forbidding its members to give interviews to magazines or to do deals with major record companies. For Riot Girl, staying out of the media spotlight was a matter of principle. Courtney Love, on the other hand, saw it as a failure of nerve at best and unforgivable snobbishness at worst.
When I went to school.
On a song called Olympia, she accused Riot Girls of all this and more.
Oh.
Including maybe the worst thing you could accuse any kind of punk of being, a clique of conformists, with no ideas of their own, who do what they're told and never think for themselves.
Well, I went to school in Olympia. And everyone's a slave. What do you do with the revolution?
By 1997, when Hole went back into the studio to record its third album, Riot Girl had hit a very low ebb, and the kind of libertarian, anything-to-everybody brand of girl power espoused by Love seemed to have carried the day.
I'm a little bit of everything, I'll roll into one.
But Riot Girl still made a good punching bag, especially when you needed to sell an idea that you felt would get indie ideologues' noses out of joint. And Celebrity Skin was one of those ideas.
Let's take what we have, our attitude, the thing, Hole, let's write a record for everybody, not for an elite core of like snotty kids that went to college, because you know what, I'm white trash, I didn't go to college.
Celebrity Skin was, just as Love suggested, a quintessential Hole album, wrapped in an irresistible candy coating. It set out its popular stall very early on with its first single,
Celebrity Skin. Thank you.
Oh, make me over, I'm all I want.
You know why?
The song was one of a number of co-writes with Billy Corgan of the Smashing Pumpkins. Another thing that irked Love's critics, which she could care less about.
She didn't write her songs. She punched me. She stole my grandmother's ring. She's on her period. Whatever. I don't care.
Eric and Billy wrote that riff at the beginning. You know why?
Why?
Because no girl would ever write that. That was self-respecting. And I looked at them both and I was like, that is gross. And Eric was like, I can see people going like this. And he made like the Satan sign at me. And Billy's like, those kids, they'll go crazy. I was like, you guys, this is so stupid. I was like, let's just make a good bridge. And then we'll see about the bad, like,
make the song
cock
about-
riff.
If Celebrity Skin sounded perilously close to the kind of macho metal that Love had set out to destroy all those years ago, this was no coincidence. On the 1999 Beautiful Monsters tour with Marilyn Manson, the group played a cover of Guns N' Roses' Paradise City. A few months later, when the whole band piled into a radio studio to pick their five favorite songs,
could I have some more tea, somebody?
They chose, among other things,
Motley Crue, Shout at the Devil,
and Guns N' Roses, Sweet Child of Mine.
We're not being ironic, it's just, it's funny. I don't know why the hell we're picking this song. There's something about it that apparently we're missing at this moment. And that's a kind of rock stardom, maybe, I guess. I don't know.
This rock stardom, she insisted, was the key to the enduring appeal of Axl Rose, and the reason why, despite herself, she found that she wanted to hear his voice again after working so hard to shut him up.
The pelvic grind.
The pelvic grind of it all.
Axl did have a good one, just like
he
Elvis.
He was a rock star.
After almost a decade of real people with real problems,
we're just going to be ourselves.
A long repressed wish for fun music made by blissfully ignorant people had finally reared its head.
It's
missed by the collective.
Nostalgia for rock stars was really nostalgia for irresponsibility, and in a way for innocence, if that isn't too strange a word to use for such a notoriously depraved scene. It was the logical conclusion of the search for alternatives to alternative, when the road away from alt-rock leads us back to its opposite, the thing it set out to destroy. No alternative, just rock.
That's the thing that's spilling out of the Camaro on a summer night. That's sure. The thing that people are fighting to and feeling great to and everything. And it's the best thing in the world.
What happened when alternative music first came out was authentic. It was a reflection of what was happening at the time, and it had to do with authenticity. So
this is the reflection of the authenticity now. We're in the reflection of it.
Music means time.
The 1990s were. It's
an alternative.
Love.
90s.
An alternative history of alternative rock.
Craig Shufton there with the fifth in his six-part series, Love in the 90s. And next week, Craig looks at how the decade-long preoccupation with realness played itself out in the last few years of the 1990s, and how artists tried to reconcile their mandate to keep it real with the demands of the inherently phony world of entertainment. And of course, you can find all the previous episodes on our website, with track listings too, and lots of great links to full interviews and extracts from Craig's book, Entertain Us. So, dive into the 90s. And while you're there, you can also browse our collection of music documentaries. Whatever your passion, you're bound to find it explored in depth in our back catalogue.